Welcome to Present Perfect. No grammar, but plenty of history. I'm Don Congdon, your host and guide, helping you explore how the past reaches out and touches the present. This is podcast number 204 of the series entitled Inflection Point, the Church of the First Century. Last time we looked into the basic ideas of dispensationalism. I went over its essential qualities and introduced my preferred version of this theological model. I also briefly mentioned my theory that during the first century AD, the dispensation in which God focused on Israel overlapped the one in which he focused upon the church. Today, we're going to develop this idea further and also introduce a few guidelines for studying this time period. Let me begin by giving you a few dates. If you're creating a timeline, jot these down because you're going to need them. The church began in AD 32 during the Feast of Pentecost. It comes in the late spring, 50 days after the Feast of First Fruits, which itself comes 2 days after Passover. Acts chapter 2 describes the key events surrounding the birth of the church. Israel formally became a nation when it met with God at Mount Sinai shortly after the Exodus from Egypt. But it lost its nation status when the Neo-Assyrians conquered the northern kingdom in the 8th century BC, and the Neo-Babylonians conquered the southern kingdom in the 6th century BC. After those events, Israel never truly existed as an independent and autonomous nation. It regained its national identity and some autonomy during the Persian, Greek, Ptolemaic, and Seleucid empires. And for a period in the 1st century BC, a few decades after the Maccabean revolts, it briefly regained independence, only to be absorbed as a client state into the Roman Republic and then the Roman Empire. Israel once again lost its nation status as a result of the First Jewish-Roman War, which began in AD 66 and ended in AD 73. The defining event of the war, the destruction of the temple in AD 70, symbolically ended the nation. While attempts by Jewish patriots to regain control erupted a number of times in the 1st and 2nd centuries, Israel never achieved nation status again until the founding of the modern State of Israel in 1948. So, if we take AD 32 as the birth of the church and AD 70 as the death of the nation of Israel, we have a period of 38 years in which the church and Israel coexisted as identifiable entities. But if we read our New Testament carefully, it's quite obvious that God is still giving Israel his attention throughout this period. This conflicts with the popular and commonly taught view that the New Testament is all about the church and that the book of Acts is the history of the early church. What's going on? It's my belief that we're seeing a transition period in which one dispensation, the time of a nation, and the next dispensation, the time of the bride, overlap. It's also my belief that they didn't just overlap, but that God offered Israel a crucial choice multiple times throughout this period. Israel's decision was highly consequential and could have led to an alternative path through history had the nation behaved differently. For these reasons, I'm going to identify the period between AD 32 and AD 70 as the transition period. And since God repeatedly offered Israel a critical choice during this time, I'll also call it the inflection point. Much of this season's podcast will focus upon these two concepts. I'll develop these ideas in much more detail later, but in summary, they solve the problems I've just mentioned. The book of Acts is not the history of the early church. It's the history of the transition period, which includes both Israel and the church. These ideas also make many of the epistles, and especially the book of Hebrews, much more intelligible. As far as I know, I've never heard these terms used in a standard church history treatment. Neither have I heard them from a mainstream church historian. Most draw a sharp line between Israel and the church at Pentecost. Similarly, most dispensationalists would identify the change between dispensations at this point as well. So, perhaps this is a new idea, or at least an uncommon one. We're going to examine this time period from two different perspectives simultaneously. We'll examine it retrospectively from our present point in history, approximately 2,000 years after the events occurred. But we'll also examine it as though we were the people living in this time period when full understanding was not yet available and important choices still had to be made. This second point of view is particularly interesting because it allows us to examine some of the what-ifs, something that you can't do in a purely historical study. The dual perspective is the reason that I'm using two titles for this period of history. From our present-day viewpoint, the term transition period emphasizes the change between dispensations. But from a project yourself into the past perspective, the term inflection point is a better choice because it emphasizes the decisions yet to be made with a future as yet unknown. Before we jump in and start examining the events leading up to this interesting time period, I'd like to make a few preliminary remarks about what we'll learn from the transition period. These are particularly applicable to us in the here and now as we study our Bibles to learn how God expects the church to conduct itself. First of all, we must be cautious about applying to our present-day churches many of the practices and guidelines that God gave to the very early church. The formative years of any institution are special, and special procedures are often necessary at this delicate larval stage. The very early church was no exception. It began with just a few thousand people living within a small geographical area. The ways in which it dealt with day-to-day matters are necessarily different from the ways that the church must operate today with millions of people spread all over the world. While there's a certain romanticism about returning to the simplicity of the early church, it's neither appropriate nor practical in most cases. We live in a much different world, and the church has left the transition period far behind. Of course, I'm not for a moment suggesting that God's expectations for present-day believers differ significantly from those that He held for believers in the very early church. But many of the procedural practices definitely are different and are not appropriate for us today. By the way, this is an excellent opportunity to practice the historical part of the literal-historical-grammatical method. By understanding where we are chronologically within the transition period, we can see practices and institutions begin, and in some cases end. We can also see the reasons for certain temporary institutions that came into existence to solve particular transitional period problems. This is yet another incentive for reading the New Testament chronologically. We see the issues and conflicts arising, followed by their prescribed solutions. We can also see that some of these are purely temporary, while others are timeless. By contrast, reading our scriptures in no particular order denies us the ability to see the unfolding narrative and keep it within a correct historical perspective. Second, we must remember that many of the phenomena present during the transition period ceased at the end of the period. Miracles, healings, prophecies, speaking in tongues, and interacting with spirit beings are common during the transition period, particularly in its early days. Several of the epistles provide guidelines governing how these gifts were to be used and evaluated. But as time goes by, these topics disappear from the pages of later books. As I'll explain in future podcasts, however, God did not intend these phenomena to continue throughout the entire church age. They existed for this brief time for a very special purpose. Despite what modern charismatics and Pentecostals claim, they are not for the church of today. If this statement bothers you, hang in there because I'll explain it more thoroughly in later podcasts. Third, we must remember that the transition period contains the two parallel paths of God's dealings with Israel and his dealings with the church. We must therefore apply both the historical and grammatical aspects of the literal-historical-grammatical method by routinely identifying the original audience of each New Testament book. When we take the time to do this, we'll see that sometimes God addresses the people of the very early church. At other times, however, he addresses the undecided of the nation of Israel. And on still other occasions, he talks to Jewish believers who are members of the very early church, but are having difficulty reconciling this new thing called Christianity with the centuries of God's dealings with the nation of Israel. Many of the early epistles contain significant instruction on how Judaism relates to Christianity. As you read your New Testament chronologically, let me encourage you to keep asking the questions, who is the audience of what I am now reading? Are God and the human writer talking to Jewish people, Jewish believers, or Gentile believers? Don't be surprised if you detect a shift of audience right in the middle of a book. While some books are aimed almost exclusively at one particular group, many speak first to one group and then another. A good example is 1 Corinthians, which has audiences of both Jewish and Gentile believers. As you may notice, however, the sense of multiple audiences diminishes as you move into later books that were written near the end of the transition period. You probably can guess the reason. The transition was almost finished, so the multiple audiences no longer exist. Revelation, the final book of the New Testament, speaks with a homogeneity that clearly signals its total focus on a single audience, the church, which has exited the transition period and is moving into the years that we now call the church age. Fourth, I'd like to stress a point that's commonly misunderstood even by the professionals in church history and, sadly, some theologians. It's the fact that neither biblical Judaism nor biblical Christianity had human founders or a period of development from primitive ideas to a mature religion. Note that I specifically said biblical to stress that we're talking about the Judaism and Christianity of the Bible and not the forms that came into existence outside of the biblical period. To clarify, I feel that it's wrong and incompatible with biblical principles to study either of these as though they evolved through human religious activity. It's certainly true that God progressively revealed his doctrines and truths to Israel over a period of centuries. But everything that he revealed perfectly dovetailed into what came before. There were no trial and error events in which an impractical idea gets replaced with a better one. While God certainly used human agents such as Moses and the various prophets to deliver his word, he fully controlled each step of the way as he constructed the picture of himself revealed in the Old Testament. Similarly, Christianity is not an evolution of the work of various founders such as Jesus and Paul. There is no tension or inconsistency between their teachings, since it all comes from a single divine source. Over the course of the first century, God delivered everything that the church needed to know, and that was the end of the matter. Of course, it took Israel, the church, and the Roman world a certain amount of time to recognize what was going on and what the relationship was between Judaism and Christianity. But God wasn't confused, and all became clear over time. By contrast, I have no trouble at all with studying religions of human origin in this way. For example, it's perfectly legitimate to discuss the evolution of Mormonism by comparing and contrasting the teachings of its founders, Joseph Smith and Brigham Young. If a historian reveals inconsistencies or tensions between their doctrines, that's fine. I wouldn't expect anything else. Nor will I quibble with approaching a corrupted Christianity in this way. For example, We can learn a lot about how the church went wrong by studying the evolution of Roman Catholicism and Eastern Orthodoxy over the centuries. Finally, by studying the transition period, we can avoid some of the extreme positions that our present-day church has fallen into. I allude to theological systems that fail to understand the distinctions between Israel and the church and misapply much of the Bible as a result. I'll give two brief examples before I wrap up. Covenant Reform theology has been around for quite a while. Although its modern form has its origin in the Reformation of the 16th century, many of its key ideas go back to the teachings of the Church Fathers in the 3rd, 4th, and 5th centuries. Its key failing is adopting a model known as replacement theology, which teaches that the Church has replaced Israel permanently. As a consequence, the Church inherits most of the promises and blessings given to Israel in the Old Testament. Similarly, many Old Testament practices and institutes have also descended to the Church in modified form. For example, the Jewish practice of circumcision comes to the Church in the form of christening through infant baptism. The Lord's Supper is a modified form of the Feast of Passover. Another example is what I loosely call Messianic Christianity. In this system, the Church isn't a distinct entity of its own, but is a collection of Gentiles who are in the process of being adopted into Israel and will eventually merge with it as a single eternal nation. This form of Christianity comes about as a misapplication of Romans chapter 11, verses 11 through 22, which uses the metaphor of cultivated and wild olive trees to explain what God is doing with Israel and the Church. Christians practicing this form of theology believe that they should observe the seven feasts of Israel described in Leviticus 23. They integrate some of the practices of Judaism into their lives and churches. Many view themselves and the church itself derisively as a kind of gutter urchin that God allows into Israel through a back door. Both of these extremes come about by failing to understand the concept of dispensationalism and the fact that much of the New Testament was written during the transition period. Once these concepts are understood, however, it becomes simple to separate the multiple audiences and understand what's aimed at Israel and what applies to the church. It's also possible to see that Israel remains God's special people and has a future role in his plans. Similarly, the church is the beloved bride of Christ. Both can take comfort in honored relationships with God and important, yet distinct, roles in the future. By the time we're finished with this podcast, I hope you'll see how this approach makes it possible to interpret and apply the New Testament in a clear and harmonious way without creating confusing dilemmas or resorting to exotic interpretational gymnastics. On that hopeful note, I'll end this podcast. Next time, we're going to examine some of the historical events leading into the first century. We'll see God's opening moves that ushered in the time of transition and decision. So until next time, I'm Don Congdon and this is Present Perfect. Have a great day. Present Perfect is a copyright of Don Congdon. Music is copyright Footage Firm Incorporated. Scripture quotations are from the New American Standard Bible, which is a copyright of the Lachman Foundation. This podcast is available on YouTube, Apple Podcasts, and Stitcher. Just search for Present Perfect Church History.